I think the first step in understanding personalization or the goals of personalization is, of course, to understand that most IBD patients present in a variety of spectrums of disease severity. There's definitely a subgroup of patients who have very mild disease, meaning those that are about 15% of all IBD patients will have a trajectory that remains stable or mild. One thing to understand is the distinction between disease activity and disease severity. I think we often confuse the two. Specifically, for a clinical trial, you have to have a certain disease activity to get into a trial and lumped in mild to moderate, moderate to severe, or severe. But the reality is that just means at a moment in time, what is your disease activity? Mainly for the last 7 days. I mean, 8 days ago, you could have had horribly active disease, but in the 7 days leading up to the trial, you could have had mild and you may be ineligible for a trial, or you'd be told to say that you are in remission, for example. But that does not take into account your lifetime risk of complication, particularly for a Crohn's disease patient. So understanding the distinction between severity and activity is very important, because often patients say to you, I feel fine. Why are you all hysterical telling me that I need this infusion or this injectable? I feel fine today. The understanding about severity is something that really needs to start getting into our communication. So we need to be able to come up with a simple way of being able to actually show patients how your risk looks like for you personally, not your cousin or your aunt's cousin who took, you know, some kind of tree bark and was cured of Crohn's disease. This is not about that. This is about you and your personal strategy. So myself and Corey Siegel and his wife, we developed a model called Prospect, which is a risk prediction whereby you put your patient's individual characteristics in, which includes age, disease duration, these serologies, NOD2 as a genetic, and you actually print out some kind of personalized risk profile for your patient sitting in front of you. So you will be able to have a visual to actually show you what your patient's trajectory is over time. So there are, as I noted, genome-wide and genomic studies that have shown that patients have certain genes are at risk of developing IBD. But what's interesting, some of the genes are tied to maybe our future targets and some of the targets we have right now. But maybe that's a gene that relates to how you will respond to ustekinumab or some of the future IL-23 monoclonal antibodies. So maybe developing gene panels that are somewhat theradiagnostic to help us understand how we're going to be using therapies in the future and choosing therapy up front. Because guess what? The first one is the most important therapy you provide your patient. So we need to get it right. And so that is where really the future of precision medicine is going. So in summary, personalized IBD care, as you think about it, one size fits all doesn't work in IBD. Risk prediction can help identify the right patient. Right therapy for right patient will be clinical as targets are developed. Right dose at the right time help optimize therapies, and decision support tools will impact personalization. Thank you so much.
So this is a 23-year-old female with 4 months of intermittent diarrhea, postprandial abdominal pain, and greater than 5% weight loss. Albumin level was 2.2, CRP 8. Subsequent evaluation due to persistent symptoms showed ileocolonic Crohn's disease. She received anti-TNF therapy and azathioprine. What factors should be individually considered to optimize therapy and counsel on prognosis?
So one of the things when you have a patient with small bowel disease and albumin of 2.2, I want to know what the extent of her disease is, because to get such a low albumin, you typically have more extensive, at least in my thoughts, is more extensive small bowel disease. Because normally, unless you have very bad colonic or very deep ulcerations in the colon for a Crohn's patient. So to me, the albumin is a risk factor, obviously malnutrition as well, which is I didn't mention, but that is a risk factor for poor prognosis as well. So for me, I'd want to know what her imaging looked like in order to sort of gauge my approach and what my target will be.
So again, we need more objective data here. So cross-sectional imaging, we prefer typically an MR enterography over a CAT scan, just because, let's be honest, our patients get more than enough radiation exposure in their lifetime, and so that's our preference. And then the SES-CD scoring system is the scoring system that we use on endoscopy to be able to grade perhaps the severity of our disease. Combination therapy on TNF, on azathioprine. Is there a time in this situation, Dr. Wabe, where you would want to, let's say she's responding and on objective evidence, endoscopy has improved, cross-sectional imaging has improved, is there a time where you may want to stop the azathioprine or stop the TNF?
So I think we know that the risk of combination therapy is there over monotherapy with biologics specifically. We know that perhaps we can stratify the risk of azathioprine in terms of malignancy when we look at some of the precipitating viral infections, EBV and CMV as one example. And we also know today that if we can do therapeutic drug monitoring versus combination therapy, that we can actually achieve good results. So personally, my practice, even in the more susceptible patient population, the younger adults and older adolescent individuals, is to use the combination therapy, but to limit it and to use more therapeutic drug monitoring and to try to risk stratify by looking at the EBV and CMV serologies before using azathioprine. So yes, but limited and more therapeutic drug monitoring.
Okay. Wasn't the question, would you stop it?
Yes.
So after monitoring, so Dr. Wabe is saying after he checks levels, make sure that at least we're at a therapeutic trough level, having enough drug in the system, then at that point it sounds like you would stop it. Which one would you stop?
The azathioprine being the higher risk. And I think, you know, we have evidence, again, in the younger patients that the anti-TNFs have better results when it comes to growth, better results when it comes to bone density, and I think that's the key thing that makes me want to continue the anti-TNF and discontinue the azathioprine. But to back to Scott's question about when would I stop and would I stop, but I don't think it's a yes-no answer. I think we have a lot of patients who are more likely to form anti-drug antibodies, and if this was a second biologic for this patient, I am very tempted to keep this patient on longer-term combination therapy. It may not be azathioprine necessarily, because we know there's a time correlation with the incidence of lymphomas and malignancy, but I would look at combination therapy in a patient getting a second biologic, second anti-TNF biologic, perhaps not the case with ustekinumab as less immunogenic.